to the number two Republican in the Senate, GOP whip John Cornyn of Texas. Senator Cornyn, thank you for joining us this morning. You just heard Leader Pelosi right there, lose-lose for the Republicans. Your response?
This is good news for the American people. We're going to get the economy roaring back again and improve pay and increase jobs and make America more competitive in the global economy, as well as simplifying the tax code and giving everybody in every tax bracket a tax cut. So this is good news any way you cut it.
Is this a done deal? Do you have the votes even if Senator McCain is not able to vote this week?
Well, I won't speculate on Senator McCain's health. We hope he comes back, but I'm confident we'll pass this bill probably on Tuesday.
So you think you have the votes right now? There's a lot more scrutiny of the bill, which was just released on Friday in these final hours, including an article in the International Business Times, which just came out yesterday, showing that a last-minute tax break, which was not included in either the House or the Senate provision, could bring millions of dollars to President Trump and other Republicans who get a lot of money from the real estate income through LLCs. Our next guest, Senator Chris Van Hollen, has responded to that, saying that slipping in a last-minute provision that could give even more of a windfall to people like President Trump and some Republicans in Congress is unconscionable. It's not too late for my colleagues to do the right thing. Will you remove that provision?
Well, our Democratic colleagues simply didn't refuse to participate in the process. We probably could have made it better if they had, but we were determined to get this job done, to cut taxes, to reform the tax code for the first time in 30 years. This will benefit hardworking American families, people in the lower income tax brackets, and everybody in every tax bracket will see a tax cut. So picking out one piece in a 1,000-page bill and saying, well, this is going to benefit somebody, I just think takes the whole bill out of context.
Well, but except that this provision wasn't included either the House or the Senate bill. It apparently was added at the last minute. Why was that done? Why was it necessary to include that provision?
Well, we were working very hard. It was a very intense process. As I said, the Democrats didn't refuse to participate. And what we've tried to do is cobble together the votes we needed to get this bill passed, at the same time maintaining the integrity of the largest tax cuts we're going to be seeing since 1986.
So is that how you got Senator Corker with this provision?
Well, the particular provision you're talking about, honestly, is just one piece of a 1,000-page bill, which is going to grow the American economy. And what we are seeing is that American corporations and businesses are not competitive in the global economy because we have the highest tax rate in the industrialized world. All we did is adopt ideas that people like Barack Obama and other Democrats have proposed when it comes to the business tax rates, and to try to get our businesses more competitive, to increase take-home pay, and to grow the number of jobs available for working class families.
I don't think they proposed that provision. But meanwhile, the Democrats are also warning that this is going to trigger a mandatory cut in many government programs, including a $25 billion cut in Medicare. Leader Pelosi has written a letter to the Senate and House leaders in the Republican Party saying, given the lack of bipartisanship to date in your effort to provide massive tax cuts to the wealthy at the expense of the middle class while adding $1.5 trillion to the deficit, it will be your responsibility to deal with the consequences. She's essentially saying you won't get any Democratic votes to waive those cuts, so $25 billion in Medicare cuts are coming. Can you prevent that on your own?
Well, that's just a false statement. We don't touch Medicare at all. We don't touch any of the entitlement programs in this bill. And so for Ms. Pelosi to make that statement, it's just fabricated.
But this proposal, the tax bill, because it increases the deficit, does trigger these pay-go provisions, which will mandate a $25 billion cut in Medicare unless you have the votes to waive it. Do you have the votes to waive it?
We will deal with that later this week. And I believe we will protect Medicare. And if Ms. Pelosi and her party will join us, that'll be a done deal.
The Democrats say they're not going to join, and that leads to the question about Senator Susan Collins. This was one of her conditions for passing the bill, along with the passage of the Alexander Murray bill to stabilize the health insurance markets. Do you have her vote, even if those provisions are not guaranteed?
Well, Senator Collins has been very constructive throughout this process, and she has vastly improved this bill by protecting taxpayers in the states with their state and local tax deduction, a $10,000 cap, which benefits everybody. And she has been a champion of trying to stabilize the affordable care market and to bring premiums down. And we will all join her in that effort to bring those premiums down and stabilize the market. And we will not trigger a cut in Medicare. We will deal with that this week. And again, I invite our Democratic friends to join us in protecting Medicare.
It looks like the Democrats are not going to be there on the tax bill. And back in 2010, when Republicans did not vote along with Obamacare, you warned the Democrats against passing the Obamacare on a party line vote in reconciliation. Let's take a look.
Well, if they try to jam it through as they have so far with strictly along partisan lines, then I think November 2010 will be a very good month for us. I think we will gain a lot more seats.
Are you concerned that history might repeat itself in 2018?
Well, we did pick up seven seats, as I recall, in 2010, following the jamming through of Obamacare. But this was done through the regular legislative process, markup in the Finance Committee and on the floor of the United States Senate. As I said, our Democratic colleagues had every chance to participate and simply refused. And it's not too late for them to join us in passing this massive tax cut and tax reform bill, which will help awaken the sleeping giant of the American economy. They can do that on Tuesday, and I hope some of them will.
Doesn't appear that any of them will, but they are banking on the fact that they think this is going to help them in 2018. Also looking to those results on Tuesday out of Alabama, where Roy Moore, the Republican candidate, lost. Of course, you were not a fan of Roy Moore in that campaign. Do you think the GOP dodged a bullet with that loss?
Well, I think the explanation for Alabama was we had a flawed candidate who won the Republican primary and who couldn't win the general election. That's really not a new lesson. That's an old lesson remembered or demonstrated once again. So what we need to do is, my party needs to do, is make sure we nominate electable candidates, good candidates, who can win general elections. I don't think the lesson of Alabama is any more complex than that. Flawed candidate, couldn't win the general election.
Does that mean that Steve Bannon has to back off?
Mr. Bannon can do whatever he sees fit. It's a free country, but I don't think his track record, particularly now in losing Alabama, one of the reddest states in the country, particularly commends him for his expertise.
One of the other X factors heading into 2018, of course, is the Russia investigation led by Special Counsel Robert Mueller. You've been pretty active on Twitter over the weekend responding to the former Attorney General Eric Holder. In one of your tweets, you said that Mueller needs to clean house of partisans. And then you were asked by, in another tweet, will you accept the findings of the Mueller probe as legitimate, by Greg Sargent of the Washington Post. You say that makes sense to me to wait and see what they are first. That sounds like you're saying that you're going to believe that Mueller's conclusions are legitimate only if you like them.
Well, no, that's not true. I have a lot of admiration and respect for Director Mueller, but I would think he would want to eliminate challenges to the integrity of his investigation by eliminating agents who have taken positions either in text messages or through their political activity that undermine the integrity.
Well, those people
of
have been taken
the,
off the
results
investigation.
Of the investigation. So I think he should want to do that, because not only is an objective investigation and justice needs to be done, the appearance of justice needs to be done, and I think these conflicts of interest jeopardize the integrity of his investigation.
The FBI agent who was engaged in those text messages, both of them have been taken off the investigation. They were taken off apparently as soon as Special Counsel Mueller found out about them.
And I commend him for that. He should. And but there ought to be, there are others who he needs to make sure he vets that team. There are plenty of FBI agents and prosecutors who have not been politically involved on behalf of Democrats or overtly critical of the president that can serve in this important investigation. So I have confidence in Director Mueller. I would just think he would be concerned about the appearance of conflicts of interest that would undermine the integrity of the investigation.
It appears that some of the president's allies in the Congress are starting to lay the groundwork for him to fire Robert Mueller. What would that mean if the president fired the special counsel?
I've read that the president's own lawyer says that's not going to happen. I think that would be a mistake myself.
Senator Cornyn, thanks for your time this morning.